Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. Good evening. My name is Raffaele Bertini, and I'm here with my colleague HP Chung from the Economic and Social Commission of the United Nations for West Asia. And we have the pleasure today to be part of this conference and introducing you to the work we did around the Arab Risk Monitor, measuring complex data for data-driven evidence-based policymaking. Let me try. Yes. The presentation is structured as follows. We start by presenting the case for data-driven risk-informed policymaking in the Arab region. Then we'll briefly introduce you to the Arab Risk Monitor framework and database to lead you towards the key highlights based on the work that we developed and based on the methodology developed of the risk trend, the risk of conflict trends in the Arab region over the last 10 years. And at the end, we'll present you briefly the future developments and directions of our work streams. Let's go briefly to the main reasons and explanations why we started this work here at NYU Center, and a work that has been fully developed inside the organization and relying on the different expertise inside the organization. But also, unfortunately, it's also related to the characteristics of the region that is pretty much facing the issue of conflict over the last decades, and as is historically as an historical legacy with conflict. But also we look at the recent trends of conflict fatalities and related indicators to see how conflict impacts not only in the short term but also in the long term, and how this can impact future conflicts. In particular, we like to look here at the battle-related deaths graphs that shows a sharp increase after the outbreak of conflict in many Arab countries after 2011. That decreased, though, in the second part of the decade to re-jump in 2021, unfortunately, mainly due to Yemen conflict. But nevertheless, and despite this decrease in battle-related deaths, other indicators that are conflict related shows an increase and remain high or increase also after the end, let's say, of the peak, after the peak of conflict fatalities in the Arab region, showing again the legacy of conflict for the region and how this represent an issue that is clearly witnessed in these recent months and days on the recurrency of conflict, different types of conflict in the Arab region. Our work is based on two main, let's say, pillars. One is more quantitative and analytical, the one that we developed and we're going to present today. And the other one is a bit more, let's say, policy-oriented, policymaker-oriented, through the dialogue and collaboration we have in place with our member states, and makes the work, let's say, also relevant in terms of the development of different strategies that are also risk-informed. So these are, let's say, in a nutshell, the two main pillars, of which the first of which we are going to focus on today in this presentation, and mainly consists of the development of this tool that has the advantage of exploring the issues that are shaping and the focus of exploring the issues that are shaping the risk of conflict, the main drivers of conflict, crisis, and instability in the Arab region. We do that by measuring vulnerability to shocks and resilience in all our countries, and by using 43 indicators across six risk domains and three main pathways. The decision to consider these indicators, domains, and pathways is all grounded in scientific literature and literature review, not only focused on the Arab region, but more conflict-related in developing context. This allows us to monitor and interpret structural trends and providing a holistic view. Let me try. When I say providing a holistic view, it means that we look at conflict from different perspectives, and especially drivers of conflict from different perspectives. Starting from the left, you can see the three main pathways: conflict, climate, and development. Conflict consists of conflicts-related variables, such as conflict grievances or any other, let's say, peace and security-related variables, including displacement, conflict proximity, and so on and so forth. The second pathway being climate, pathway that consists of natural resources and climate hazards that looks at dimensions that are particularly relevant also for the region. And the development pathway consists of economy, society, and institutions to consider together the socioeconomic institutional dimension that are also very relevant of drivers of conflict in the region. At the extreme right of this slide, you also see that that these pathways and domains are divided into two main dimensions, that are vulnerability and resilience. In fact, we define risk as a function of vulnerability and resilience. This is particularly relevant in the context of conflict prevention, as a distinction between let's say structural and non-structural policy-driven factors at key advantages. First of all, it looks at the interplay, the mechanisms between vulnerability and resilience. Then it helps to unpack the complexity of risk, revealing what country can do and what cannot do to mitigate, or on the contrary, to exacerbate the risk of conflict. This is also true also for programs. And at the end, this allows profound understanding of risk and to tailor response strategy and formulate effective policy. Again, risk as a function of vulnerability and resilience that is presented here in this matrix, where on the vertical axis we have the level of vulnerability and on the horizontal axis we have the level of resilience. So the lower is the level of resilience, the higher is the risk, and the higher is the level of vulnerability, the higher is the risk. And the combination of the two gives us, let's say, the different level of risk for each and every drivers of risk. All these colors will be more meaningful in coming slides. But before presenting the results, can UHP presenting us showing us what are the basic characteristics of the data infrastructure that you and the team developed? Over to you, HP.
Thank you, Raffaele. Just to continue on what Raffaele was saying, I come from the data field, and one of the problems that we often face is that we do have data, but interpretation is quite difficult. And for us in the data field, I think this framework that Raffaele just presented is critical to not only frame how we see risk and the different factors that drive risk, but also allow for interpretation for concrete and targeted policymaking for both prevention and recovery. With that being said, we have developed, as one of the components of the Arab Risk Monitor, we have developed a database and an accompanying data infrastructure. So I just wanted to walk you through the different dimensions of this database. So first of all, the indicators were chosen, as Raffaele mentioned, based on, of course, scientific literature and relevancy. So we've done a thorough literature research and desk research on which indicators measure underlying concerns when it comes to increase in vulnerability, as well as the decrease in resilience. So that's one of the first criteria we've used to choose indicators. The second one is we've chosen only open source data or open access data that comes from reputable and established databases and institutions. So for us, availability was key. And we will discuss this later on a little bit more, but one of the reasons why we did this is the nature of our office being a regional commissions. We have the privilege to work directly with countries, and we do not want to work on any data sets that they cannot readily and with marginal cost replicate. Of course, data availability has a factor in terms of coverage, both time across time and across places. So we have chosen the indicators that had a decent amount of time series. Of course, that differs by the indicator, as well as full geographic coverage for the Arab region, but also beyond. This is also related to the frequency of data releases. So we have chosen databases that are frequently updated to ensure that the policymakers and the users of the Arab Risk Monitor receive the latest data possible. And we also prioritized SDG indicators and other internationally agreed data sets. So that, again, that's also related to the availability and also the prioritization when it comes to the UN-wide data strategy. Next slide, please. So our data set consists of 43 variables around 30 plus years. Although the results we present today will focus on the 22 Arab states, we do have data for across these time series for all of the countries. And I think that's one thing that we do want to emphasize as well, that while this project is called the Arab Risk Monitor, it is applicable and flexible for other applications, other region, and across the globe. We will see a little bit more throughout the presentation, how we can also zoom down, but I'll leave that up to future slides. So we went through a data processing procedure to ensure that the data are transformed and normalized so they are comparable and, again, easily interpretable. Next slide, please. So this is just a standard data processing mechanism, as many of you are probably familiar with, but this is just to show the different steps that we've taken to ensure that we have high quality data that is applicable to risk-informed policymaking. Next slide, please. So here is a brief visualization on the different data that we have and different variables we have. So we do see in the center of the circle, the three pathways, and the second from the innermost circle are the six dimensions. And we do see the individual indicators for each of the dimensions as well. Next slide, please. Okay, so having said that, I think this is also a very good point to mention that the database also consists of a data processing mechanism. We have automated 90% of our data collection and processing steps. Later on in the presentation, again, we'll talk about some of our visions to improve this infrastructure, but also our visualizations have been automated through R, Python, Tableau, Excel. So I just want to, before we go into the key highlights, I want to emphasize the fact that all of these visualizations and tables and analytical insights are very process oriented and to a large extent automated. So for example, if you're a client if you want to work with us, or if you want to get some information for our Arab Risk Monitor, we are readily available. We'll be happy to share insights that are specific to your demands. But the key highlights in this section will just showcase some of the more pertinent trends that we see as a result of our monitor. So first of all, we want to show this graph, and this basically shows the six dimensions as well as the interconnectivity of risk between the dimensions. So each ribbon represents the number of countries who are at high risk or very high risk in some cases, and very high risk in some cases across the different dimensions. So from this chart, we can clearly see that risk in the region does not happen in a vacuum. a lot of the countries who have institutional weakness do also share other vulnerabilities and lower resilience across different risk dimensions. Next slide, please. I believe, Raffaele, you can better explain this slide.
Sure. Thanks a lot, HP, for giving back the floor. So as HP was saying, here we have a trend analysis of the period, let's say before, of the period from 2010 to 2021 that we selected that is in a sense as a, let's say the pre-conflict period during the peak of conflict 2015 and the most recent year at that point in time, just making a point that we're also working on the development for 2022 as we are approaching the end of 2023. But this is again in related to the data that is delivered at annual level. So this overarching analysis shows how the main drivers of risk at domain levels are indeed the natural resources risk and the institutional risk, that both at vulnerability and resilience level shows combined a low level of risk. Others are also showing moderate or minor level of risk, and I'd like also to emphasize few peaks, let's say a few dimensions that are reflected in the data, but also based on our common understanding. For instance, the conflict vulnerability in 2015 reached the highest level compared to the rest of the period. Here we have to consider also that we are doing a regional average, so don't be surprised in not seeing the conflict risk as part of the most significant risk. Again, natural resources and weak institutions are two of the main drivers that perpetuate conflict and instability in general in the Arab region. HP, do you want to explain us this?
So this scatter plot is a very basic representation of how our data and our monitoring tool can inform policymakers or show key trends. So on the vertical axis, we see vulnerability for a combination of the three pathways. And on the horizontal axis, we see resilience. So, and also we've classified countries by different colors. The size of the bubble represents the relative population size of each Arab country. We avoided labeling the countries, but of course we do have the data and we do have the specific data in our report. But I wanted to share with you two insights that we have. It's self-evident, but nonetheless. So we see from this graph that vulnerability and resilience are highly correlated, meaning 10 countries who tend to have high risk vulnerability also tend to have low risk resilience and vice versa. We also see a very clear clustering of countries. So we have three categories of countries, and we see that without any surprises, that the countries that are in fragile and conflict-affected situations tend to have much significantly higher risk of vulnerability and also significantly lower risk resilience. Next slide, please. So this is a similar scatter plot for vulnerability versus resilience for the six different dimensions. And we observe also that depending on the nature of the risk dimension, it differs quite significantly. For example, climate hazard, it's not really a function of, some countries have high amount of vulnerability, but at the same time, very high resilience. Whereas, for example, in institutions, the vulnerability and resilience factors are highly correlated. And again, we do find that this is quite soothing for us, at least for us in the data field, because this does hold true, or this does make sense in the real world. Next slide, please. Raffaele, I think this is your report.
Oh, sure. Yeah, sure. Okay. HP. So we are going deeper in our analysis here. As you see, we are not looking at risk domains or pathways, but we are looking at indicator level. So this will help us to understand, especially policymakers, to understand what is the level of risk induced by the different indicators. In particular, we like to emphasize here how natural resources and institutional vulnerabilities are among the highest in terms also of indicators. We have water scarcity and corruption, as well as other institutional and conflict and also economic food insecurity. I'd like briefly to emphasize what just one result, if you allow me, like the neighboring country, how it increased, it peaked in 2015 due to the spread of conflict all around the region. And it reduced in recent years, at least till 2021. But again, this was well capturing, let's say, the evidence, the reality, unfortunately, on the ground. Well, I continue here, HP, if you allow me. So before we look at indicators for on the vulnerability, and here we look at the resilience. Again, the lower is the indicator, the higher is the risk. So the lower is the level of resilience, the higher is the risk. So among the top, let's say, drivers of risk from the lack of vulnerability side, there is a limited presence or development of social protection schemes, as well, let's say, the issue of water stress and the lack of voice and accountability among the main one. Of course, there are also very important and cross-cutting, regardless of the domain of risk. I stop it here, otherwise we don't have too much time. But I'd like to ask you, HP. So here it is. What was the risk monitor at its stand for now? But what's after? What's after this? Do you have any plan?
We do have a shared vision together. It is to expand the uses across the different regional and international mechanisms. Also collaborate closely with partners, including NGOs, member states, so on and so forth. So right now, our air risk monitor is being used by member states. We have a couple of member states that are implementing the risk monitor in at a national context. And we have about two that have agreed to implement, and I think we have about six more who are planning to. Also, it is used by various UN agencies, including the UN Operations and Crisis Center, particularly for the MENA reviews. We also provide, based on the data and the analysis from the Arab Risk Monitor, we provide inputs into various agencies, including UNDP, UNDRR, et cetera, et cetera, for both the regional and the country teams. In terms of future development, so we do believe we have a solid infrastructure. So everything is set in place. It has been verified by our partners, including member states, experts in the field, as well as UN agencies. And I think now it's time to expand on this tool. So some of the things that we want to do includes indicators on impact, particularly the disaggregated data on vulnerable populations, including people with disabilities, youth, and of course, women. We also want to expand this regional and national tool at the subnational level. In the next slide or so, I'll present some of the provisional data that we have at the subnational data for Yemen. Also, we want to incorporate more timely and innovative data sources, including GIS and big data. We are also trialing various AI and machine learning based algorithms to improve the availability of risk data, particularly for countries in conflict, where unfortunately there isn't much data and there's quite a number of significant gaps. Next slide, please. So as mentioned before, this is our preliminary results for the Arab risk monitoring at the subnational level for Yemen. We have presented some of the results at the administrative level one or the gubernatorial level, but we do have data for the AT level or the district level as well. You can see that for conflict is focused on conflict for both resilience and vulnerability is focused on a couple regions. And I think, Raffaele, you can better explain a little bit about the thinking when it comes to subnational risk monitors.
Thank you, HP. Yes, this is another challenge we are facing, but we are happy, let's say, to work on this. That we hope to give more nuance, especially to policymakers and practitioners and experts at a more subnational at the subnational level. What we are doing was exploiting data available and, let's say, trying to locate within the same framework of the Arab Risk Monitor that was presented in the beginning of this presentation by using different proxies. Of course, the approach data-wise is different, as we are not necessarily looking at the same variables and indicators, but we are building the exercise space on a national level. And when I mean national level, I mean also the distribution of data at national level. So we are not comparing, let's say, the situation in Yemen with the situation in Egypt, but we are using data only for Yemen. We think that for now this is really important, because it refers to the subnational specificity of the same country and can inform the policymaker accordingly. Of course, we can try to adapt this to different kind of methodologies, but for now these are just the preliminary results that we are pretty happy with. And again, this can be even investigated further by looking at district level or focusing on specific area, for instance, the western part of the country that has been particularly affected by conflict over the last years. Happy to receive questions about this. Stop it here.
Yeah, I think we're running out of time, but we do want to get some questions if there are any. So can we skip directly to the Q&A? Is that okay with you? We have a couple two more slides, I think, but I think we've mentioned some of this in the beginning, so it's okay.
Please, over to you.
So please, if anybody has any questions regarding what we've presented, we'd be happy to hear them. Through the organizers, we'll also share our contact details as well as the slides, including links to some of our publications and our tools. So please feel free to contact us afterwards. But if there's any questions at this point, we'll be happy to take them.
I think we have questions in the chat box, HP.
Yes. So I think the organizers unfortunately have
to close. You want to take the first?
Yes. Just to quickly mention, we do want to use a little bit more real-time data. We don't really particularly have any type of data that we are averse to. So please, if you have any suggestions for us, I mean, we saw some very interesting presentations earlier on the conference. And if you want to reach out to us with suggestions, we'd be very happy to take them. For the second question, right now, about around 5 to 6 member states are trying to implement or planning or implementing the Arab Risk Monitor and the results, but the entire framework to be more specific. In terms of stakeholder organizations, we have about 10 UN, about 6-7 UN agencies and about 2-3 NGOs that are reaching out to us currently or have been using our analysis and our data. I hope that answers your question. And I think with that, Raffaele, would you like to conclude?
Well, yes. Again, reiterating your invitation to contact us at any time. We'll be happy to receive your comments and get in touch with you and benefit from your expertise. It's a beginning of a process. So unfortunately, we really see the need also with the current events to better understand and better shape policies in the region. And not only, of course, there are risk sensitive. And so we'll be extremely happy to continue working with you and receive your feedbacks on what has been already done. We'll be happy also if you agree with me, HP, to share with colleagues and with the organizers that we thank now, to share the next steps of what has been of what will be done with them, in order to keep in touch also on this side. Over to you, and we can close the session if you want. Thank you so much. Have a good rest of the day and a nice weekend ahead.